Today, I'm going to talk to you about how to run parallel bytecode interpreters on heterogeneous hardware. And this includes multi-core CPUs, GPUs, and FPGAs, all of them using the same code base. So the motivation for this work is that today's heterogeneous hardware are everywhere. Your laptop, your smartphone, you know, your tablet, servers, data centers. All of them include some sort of heterogeneous hardware in some more or less place. Right? Those heterogeneous hardware are now currently used, the main use is to speed up end user applications. However, there's a little work how to exploit those heterogeneous hardware for system tools like operating system or managed runtime languages, some components of the managed runtime languages. So in this talk, I focus on managed runtime languages and I focus how to speed up bytecode interpreters on GPUs and FPGAs. So my research questions are the following. Assuming we have heterogeneous systems and heterogeneous hardware are everywhere, first question, can we run an interpreter on multiple different heterogeneous devices using the same code base? And the second question is, can we increase performance? So the idea is not new. For example, in the context of garbage collection, there has been some workaround. For example, 2010, there is a patent by AMD, GPU assisted garbage collection. There is a nice paper, 2012 by Martin Mas, ISMMN 2012. And more recently, there is a paper regarding generational garbage collection for integrated GPUs. It's called Fast Collect. This paper, instead of garbage collection, is focused on bytecode interpreters. So what's around? We found one paper, Uppsala last year, actually, and they claim it's the first work to do a CUDA interpreter, which is basically a bytecode interpreter to run on CUDA devices. The difference between their work and our work is that their interpreter is single thread, and it doesn't exploit the full capability of the GPU in terms of memory. I will expand what I mean this later on. So our work is a parallel bytecode interpreter, and we fully exploit capabilities of the device instead of in terms of memory. Okay, so let's go to the details. We took we took the idea and then researching on the web, we found this link. It's a very nice talk by Professor Terence Parr. I think many of you know this talk already. So he describes a very simple way to implement a very basic interpreter for Java. So what we did was, okay, let's take this interpreter and let's port it to OpenCL. So we actually extended with more bytecodes and basically some of the semantics we have to change a little bit to adapt it to the OpenCL perspective. So let me show you an example. The interpreter is composed by integer operations, division, addition, multiplications, and subtraction. We also include shift operations, but just for fun, comparisons as well, and then memory operations, local load stores, and also introduce global stores and loads in an array format, let's say. This is better for us to index in OpenCL perspective. Also, we have control flow operations, branch is true, branch is false. We can do function calls as well. And then we can do operations like typical operations in bytecode, so like pop, push, and stack, duplication, unload directly constants in there. We also have an auxiliary bytecode for printing. That's useful for us if you want to print, let's say, on the GPU. Basically, what we do is to push something in a buffer, and then we print after that. And those are the bytecodes we generate. And let me show you with an example. And I show you the vector multiplication. I will use this example in the whole presentation. And on the left side, you see a list of bytecodes that represent the vector multiplication. And on the right-hand side, I show you the heap. So it's a stack machine. The right-hand side is the heap, and the middle, I show you the stack. Okay? And I go through it just very quickly, how this works. The heap, we're dividing in several chunks. It could be any position, but to index data in the OpenCL perspective is easier for us if we're dividing into sections. Right? But it doesn't matter really. So we load the first element, constant zero, and that element is going to be used as an index for the loop. So we have vector addition, we have a loop, and then we multiply each element of the vector. We duplicate the stack, And then we compare, are we reaching the end of the loop? No. We compare it, and then we continue. We don't branch. We duplicate the values, which is basically the index. Then we go to global memory, and then we say, okay, go to global memory, base address is going to be size, and the offset is going to be what is in the top on the stack, which was zero. And then we load the data from the first array. We load the index. We can do like put on top of the stack whatever is in the index below. So with like top minus one, something like that. Then we can load the second element, and then we can multiply it. Then what we do, we store the data on the heap again using the base address written by the bytecode, and the offset will be the top of the stack. And then we increment the counter. Just pretty easy, right? So this is a minimal, let's say, bytecode that will allow us to do something, let's say, useful, linear algebra on GPUs. So let me show you now how we did this in OpenCL. So we generate OpenCL underneath, okay? We actually wrote it in OpenCL. And this is the flow for our interpreter. We have one thread on the host side that is gonna configure the whole execution and send the data to the device, to the GPU or the FPGA. Then the code is gonna copy to global memory. We have a heap that is gonna be allocated on global memory of the device. And the stack, our first version, we took it as a global memory. And on the device, we launched a single thread. That was our first initial experiment. We ported to C++, and we ported to OpenCL. And let's see how we did it. So, just to give you an idea how the bytecode looks like, how the interpreter looks like. This is an OpenCL code, a sketch of the actual interpreter. It will be open source soon. I need the time to clean it up a bit and put some documentation. Now there is practically no documentation in there, but it will be available soon. Actually, feel free to ask me if you want to see it before that. And it's basically pretty simple while loop, and then we get the bytecode, and then we have a very large switch statement and just, you know, execution of the bytecodes. Pretty simple. So how do we did it? Here I show you a performance graph. So x-axis shows input size for the vector multiplication. It's the example I showed you before. Y-axis shows time in nanoseconds, so the lower the better. First bar is a C++ code running on CPU, so baseline interpreter. The second is the OpenCL, single thread, on CPU. Then for GPUs, so the two bars are NVIDIA GPU and integrated graphics Intel GPU. And the last one is FPGA. And as you can see, the GPU is like three orders of magnitude, as well as this FPGA, three orders of magnitude slowdown compared to the C++ version. That's very bad. However, let's look at the Intel implementation. It's very, very close to the actual C++ compiled with O3. So there is a reason for this. And this is expected, by the way. So CPUs, in Intel, we have branch prediction. But on GPUs, there is no branch prediction. And our code is full of branches. And we are running single thread on a GPU that contains physically, you can launch 3,500 threads, so imagine. We're not using nothing, well, I think practically anything of the capability of the GPU. Okay, so far, can we do it better? So first we show that yes, it's possible to write this exactly same interpreter to run on many different devices. That's something new because compared to the previous works, they only focus on one single device. So the Uppsala paper, for example, only focus on CUDA on NVIDIA, which we can run now on an FPGA, on integrated graphics, or GPUs. Right? But performance is not good. So what can we do to get performance? Well, we could do two things, at least. We tried two things, actually. So first of all, let's expose the parallelism in the interpreter side. So we expose in the bytecode level the thread ID. I will show you how it's done in a bit. Another thing we could do is to expose the memory region, so fully exploit all the tier memory of the capability of the GPU and FPGAs. And I will show you how it's done in a bit. So let's start with the first one, the thread ID. So thread ID is pretty simple. We expose a new bytecode, and then we have obviously a new case. And it's basically pushing on top of the stack the local ID, or global ID, in this case is local ID, of the value of the GPU, right? So imagine that we're running thread at 3, could be thread at 1,000, that value will be on top of the stack. And that value will be used later on to index data in the heap. The second thing to do is to exploit local memory regions or memory regions. For that, I need slide of background very briefly, because OpenCL is a monster. So here I show you this different tier memory that are available on GPUs and FPGAs using the OpenCL programming model. So each work item has access to private memory. Those are physical registers on GPUs and FPGAs. Then you can combine many work items in what is called a work group, and they can share memory in a region called local memory. This region should be 2 to 3 times faster than global memory. Then we have a big chunk that is going to act as a global memory. And then we have a small space in global memory called constant memory. That, depending on the driver, that could give you extra speed up. That's driver dependent, okay? So you're using NVIDIA PTX, that could give you better performance than other drivers. But as soon as we promise that the data is not going to be changed, we can get extra speed up there. So let me show you how the execution flow looks like for this version. We have a single thread that is going to run on the host side, on the CPU, that is going to be coordinating the execution of the whole GPU and FPGA. That thread will push, will write into constant memory the code. So the code, we assume, is not going to change. Code means bytecode. So our bytecode is a list of integers. We will transfer there. Then instead of having one single heap, we will have many global heaps, which with this we want to increase locality. So the GPUs, the transactions are 128 bytes, so which means that with 128 is in a cache line, so we can hit the same value for all of them. Then we can transfer data from global to local. Then we always operate on local memory once we run the interpreter on the device. And then each thread will have its own private memory. So the stack is going to be private, which means physical registers. That's the schema, the overview. And let me show you an example. So here is the same vector multiplication. As you can see now, we have less bytecodes to run. It's very compressed. So just to recap, we have one stack per thread. Those GPUs and FPGAs can run thousands of threads, so we'll have thousands of stacks. The code is going to be copied to constant memory. All threads will have access to constant memory. Then all threads will have access to global memory, but threads within the same work group will have to copy the content of global to local, and then we will always operate in local memory. Let me show you a trace as well as I did before with this example. I'm gonna show you with one thread, but you need imagine to scale this like 1,000 threads. So we push on the stack the thread ID. Let's say we're running thread 120. Then we duplicate the value in the stack, we duplicate the thread ID, and these are gonna be used to index data from global memory. So then we go, okay, go to heap. We have several heaps now. We need to decide which heap we're going to use. And then we pass an extra parameter to the interpreter, to the bytecode parallel gload indexed, to say which heap you want to use. And then we say, put on top of the stack, go to heap 0 and put the value that is pointing to because of the thread ID. So basically, the thread ID is used as an index to go to global memory. Then we push again to the stack the thread ID, and then we load the second element. We multiply them, and then we store the result in the last heap. Here I show you an example with 3 heaps, but could be any number of heaps as soon as you have space on the actual GPU and FPGAs. Okay, it could be any number. And then we just finish the execution. And you need to imagine this, not one thread, but thousands of threads running this. It actually, what is going to happen is if you are using NVIDIA GPUs, you're going to run with block of 32, which is called a warp, all of them executing exactly the same instruction. So even if the code is branchy, we have many branches inside, because all of them are running on the same branch, you are not going to get too much performance degradation because of the switch statement. Okay, so let me show you how we did. Here, I show you again performance results. So x-axis shows input size, y-axis shows, this is different now, speed up against ARM. You might wonder why ARM. Okay, so ARM, this processor is the Raspberry Pi processor. It runs at 1 gigahertz. The FPGA we use is 300 gigahertz. Our first goal was to get speed ups on FPGAs. We didn't manage that. We were very close. Actually, we ran, I think, 14, 15 different versions of FPGA. It's very time consuming because each version takes 3 hours to compile on the FPGA. Well, we managed to be close, but we didn't handle to go faster than ARM. Nevertheless, the first bar shows speed up against R by running the C++ interpreter, which was our baseline in the first iteration. And then the rest are GPUs and FPGA. And well, there are a few things to notice here. First of all, let's focus on this number. So the execution on NVIDIA is 200x compared to ARM and 150x compared to Intel. So if we take the Intel graphics. If we compare against the Intel C++, so we run the C++ baseline compile interpreter, we get a difference of 10 times faster when you use the Intel integrative graphics and 17x compared if we use the NVIDIA GP100. So we go from slowdown, 1000x, to 20x almost. That's great. So. And this is possible because we expose the thread ID, the whole interpreter is running inside, and we also use the all memory regions available on the GPU. For FPGAs, we don't get speedups though. We are experimenting and understanding why. It's very hard because although OpenCL can run there and the results are correct, getting speed is a different story. OpenCL is not, the performance is not portable. We have to tune many, many parameters, compute units, local memory size, you know, how the threads are configured inside for each kernel to get different combinations and then analyze them. Still, we haven't got the actual combination to get speed up. But we are close. Okay, so, Juan, you showed me a very basic interpreter. How can this be useful in the real world? Okay, so, I'm going to talk about a few pointers and I'm not going to talk about all of them. So for example, imagine an embedded world, you know, a lot of embedded systems. Perhaps you don't have the memory to perform the JIT compilation. And just by offloading part of the interpreter to the actual GPU or the FPGA, assuming we can get speeders from the FPGA, can give you better performance. And you can save energy as well because those devices consume less energy. They operate at lower frequency as well, and you can consume less energy. Examples are, for example, Intel, I remember, they have been working on integrating FPGAs with CPUs. Maybe soon we will have laptops with FPGAs inside, hopefully. There is another project, it's gonna come up next year. You can get an ARM, and there is what is called ARM custom instructions. Basically, it's an ASICs that you can program wherever you want. Perhaps you could do GC collection, bytecode interpretation, things like that. It's called ARM Cortex M33, if you want to have a look. Another point I want to make is, well, obviously the bytecodes that I show you is not Java bytecode. Java bytecodes are very complicated, or .NET, or whatever language you might think about. So how can this be useful? Well, we could do a phase, ahead of time phase, that if your application follows SIMD patterns, single instruction, multiple data, or single instruction, multiple thread in the case of GPUs, or pipeline patterns, you might have a phase that you translate those bytecodes to something more GPU friendly. By doing that, you're not changing the semantics, you're just changing how bytecodes are gonna run, and you can take advantage of execution on those hardware. I believe that's useful, okay? I don't think it's feasible for cases. Is for example, linear algebra cases, you know, deep learning, matrix multiplication, those cases consume a lot of resources, compute resources, so you might get benefit from this. Okay, so I'm gonna jump to the takeaways. So as a takeaway, I would like to remember that Heterogeneous hardware is here to stay. We could take advantage of them not only for accelerating end-user applications, but also to do system tooling, right? For example, operating systems, GC, interpreted bytecodes, and so on and so forth. There have been some work in GC collection. I show you here a technique to run bytecode interpreters fully, entirely on GPUs and FPGAs. And it's fully, we also run on multi-cores as well, so because the code is exactly the same. And as a takeaway for my technique, there are two things that are different compared to other works. Is my interpreter is parallel. It's not a single thread, but rather it knows, it has the knowledge of thread ID. So you can index data in parallel. And as far as I know, there's no other bytecode interpreter that fully exploits heterogeneous, you know, different tier memories of available on the actual hardware, like local memory, private memory, constant memory, and so on and so forth. From this, there are a lot of work to do in the future world. This is just the beginning. For example, compare against existing tools, existing languages, how we do it. Rewriting this technique instead of with OpenCL, but rather with Inter One API is an API that came along last November, if I remember, that allows us to run C++ code on heterogeneous hardware and see how we do this. Yeah. With that, I'm happy to take questions. That's the end of my presentation. Yeah, thank you very much for your attention.